Praise the Lord for another day. Angels, we have heard a light echoing o'er the plains and the mountains in reply, echoing their joyous strains.
Still we see thee ride above. Until the Son of God. to see you, Sam. You don't have to look very far to figure out, or at least to observe, that there's just lots of unrest in our world. I know it's Christmas time, and I'm going to get there. This really is a Christmas sermon. I mean, America's filled with all kinds of crime, famine, inflation, the constant badgering of a former president, family struggling with all kinds of domestic and financial problems. There's some kind of unrest everywhere you look. The world is unrest because most folks have never found that path to peace in their own heart. They're in a state of personal stress, unrest, still seeking a way to survive the upside down feeling they have in their heart. Well, this is the Christmas season, and there's no shortage of offers of toys, mattresses, that'll change your life because you sleep better. Not the toys so much. There's a better car to buy or some other gadget that's going to bring happiness. Happiness. That is a really popular word. I just want to be happy. The problem with happy is the word itself. Happy has as its root word. Root concept is happenstance, making happiness really circumstantial or a response to circumstances. But that's not the piece. Circumstantial happiness, it's a good thing. It's a good thing to feel euphoric in some way, to feel happiness. Glad that you've accomplished something or that something's happened well in your business or your personal life. All those things are not bad. But if our well-being is dependent, our feeling of well-being is dependent on circumstances, you know, every day, how your whole day can go great for a while and not so great and then better and then maybe really down the tube. And tomorrow, it may be just the opposite. But life fluctuates. Things happen. People happen. And that's not always a happy experience. Because people are scrambling. You're grappling. Peace and here. And I can't think of a better subject at Christmas time than talking about what the scripture calls the Prince of Peace. Listen to Isaiah chapter 9:6. There's scriptures listed in your bulletin that you may want to take home. And they're listed, they're not written out for you. But we use this verse all the time at Christmas time. For unto us a child is born, is Isaiah prophesying. Unto us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder, and his name shall be called Wonderful, Counselor, Mighty God. Those would be good sermon points, but I didn't use them that way. Everlasting Father and Prince of Peace. That gives us the key to where we might find this peace that we're all looking for. And I know even we as Christians that have met Jesus Christ and he's a part of our life and we have the Prince of Peace within us in the person of the Holy Spirit. That wasn't supposed to come till later. But anyway, sometimes we tend to, at least momentarily, forget that peace is there and rely on it. And know that this circumstance hits us upside the head. I get lots of texts from Caleb like this. This happened, and I finally figured out, I guess I owe you lunch on this one. And I finally figured out that I wasn't in control, but that he was, and to go with it. That's when you know.
I forgot again.
But we all forget. We forget, at least momentarily, that the Prince of Peace is in there. And we, circumstance can come, but we know in our heart of hearts that it's okay. But happenstance is not going to bring that inner peace. Inner peace is the answer to everyday living. Inner peace can only come from one source. We just talked about that. Let's back up to 7:14 of Isaiah. The Lord, therefore, the Lord himself will give you a sign. Now, this is Isaiah prophesying to Ahaz, the king of Judah, about the fact that Judah's not going to be overrun just yet. But it's almost like an exact quote, and there is a quote of Isaiah 7:14 in the New Testament. For the Lord himself will give you a sign. Behold, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and that his name shall be called. Can you say it with me? Emmanuel. And that means God with us. What did Jesus say? I'll never leave you or forsake you. That's what happened when Jesus entered the world. God with us. Now, when Jesus came, God was physically with us on the earth, walking about, teaching and preaching and sharing his life, his love, and changing the lives of people. Some he healed. Well, all he healed. Some physically, some mentally, some emotionally, and some spiritually. Well, all spiritually if they would accept him. We know they didn't all accept him because they finally killed him. That was his goal all along. Isn't it funny how people think they're doing things, they may be thinking they're getting revenge or they're touting their own way. God's up there smiling. You just did what I wanted you to. Because if you hadn't done that, and you know, Jesus, you know, they're nailing his hands. He says, forgive them. That's inner peace. I realize this is Jesus talking, okay? You know, I realize we're not him. But he's right there. He's right there. He's walking with us. He's talking with us. He's leading us. And he's talking every day, teaching us every day something new. And when something negative comes along, it just gives us an opportunity to say, hey, Jesus, I can't handle this. You take care of it. So I heard an evangelist one time say, Satan comes knocking at the door, and you realize that it's not who you want to see. And so instead of going to the door, he said, Jesus, would you get that? That's God with us. God with us. Jesus Christ in the person of the Holy Spirit is right here, inside. It'd be technically better be up here. Guiding, moving, motivating, chiding, pulling the reins back a little bit. Slow down, Bob. Slow down. I got this. Yes. Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. When you have that peace, all of those things fall into place. Wonderful Counselor. Just the wonder of life itself. Do you ever think of taking in a big, deep breath and saying, I'm still breathing. That is good. And that is from God. Every breath we breathe is a gift. If we could only be better at remembering. Colossians 1:26 says this. The mystery that has been kept hidden for ages and generations is now disclosed to the Lord's people. To them, God has chosen to make known among the Gentiles. This is Paul now, book of Colossians. Chosen to make known among the Gentiles, listen to this phrase, the glorious riches of this mystery, which is Christ Jesus. Christ Jesus. In you, the hope of glory. Not your personal glory, but the hope of, I remember my mom and my dad referring to going to heaven as going to glory. And the knowledge and the assurance of knowing that glory is inevitable in the future is another addition to the peace that the Prince of Peace brings into our lives. A lot of people try a lot of things, and all they're looking for is peace, but they don't even know it. They're always looking for some kind of satisfaction, just like the song, the rock song back in the day, can't get no satisfaction. Satisfied. Jesus satisfies our needs on every possible level if we're listening, if we're leaning. You know that song, Lean On Me, when you're not strong. That's Jesus talking to you. I don't think Jesus actually wrote the song, but I think the guy that wrote it was hearing a voice that he didn't think he was hearing. Lean on me when you're not strong. Well, for me, that's most of the time. You know how to know if you're leaning on Jesus? You ever been leaning on a pole or a cane or something like that and somebody kick it out from under you? Or just lose your footing. And I never will forget the day. Thank you, Holly. I was chasing a rooster. It was like 7 in the morning, and y'all know that Daddy does not get up at 7. Her alarm goes off at 9. Now that she works at the Citadel, things are different. And she's got students she has to get up, and things are different. But I was ticked off at that rooster for, I was right there under the living room window. Why he couldn't do it over here where he roosts every night. So I decided I was going to fix it. So I charge him like I'm going to really get after him. I took 2 steps. And there's a big rock right at the corner of the house. And I forgot. And before I knew I was falling, my face was in the dirt. I mean, it was just that quick. Fortunately, I wasn't gravely injured. But I was even madder at the rooster. And a little bit madder at myself because I just remembered the rock was there. Sometimes there's rocks, and we know they're there, but we kind of go too close to them anyway. I did that day. I just forgot. I knew it was there. It had been there since we lived here 5 years. The glorious riches of this mystery, which is Christ in you, the hope of glory. Life is a mystery, an unwritten novel that's being written every day by you. How's it going? The Holy Spirit is that part of the Trinity that lives within us. There's comfort. We need comforting sometimes. There's guidance. We need that all the time. There's joy, which is a step beyond peace, and that's good when we feel joyous and exciting. This is a terrible spiritual comparison, but when our team makes a touchdown, we get excited. Jesus already made the touchdown. And I knocked the mic off. I'm glad that we can laugh. I've never thought of myself as a comedian, but I do some weird, funny things sometimes. But here's the thing. Last thing Jesus said, and I know I tell you this again and again and again, and I'm not stopping. The last thing he said, go and tell him. Tell him what I told you, what I taught you. He teach them to live in this life of peace, this life of assurance, this life of a willingness to be a giver of life to others. And that brings a joy you can't imagine when you pray with someone to receive Christ. And for a moment you might think you did something. Well, you did. You obeyed. Because the last part of that phrase is, teach them to obey whatsoever I have commanded you. Yes, it's a gift. But with a gift comes responsibility. I know it wasn't intended a gift when it was given, but I was given a responsibility several years ago when the church bought that really nice lawnmower. And it's important to me. I don't have to mow right now, and that's a good feeling. But I get out there and I start mowing, and I really am enjoying myself, watching that grass smooth out. But with a gift comes responsibility, is my point. And that's a responsibility that I personally welcome. So what we need to do is be sure that folks know that Christmas is about Jesus. I have a dear old friend. In fact, I recently wrote a song about him. He was such an interesting man and loved God like nobody's business. But if you ever saw him at Christmas time, he'd say, "Hey, Bob, Merry Christmas." Emphatically, because that's really what Christmas is. It's Christmas, it's not Christmas. It's okay to say Christmas, but I love the fact that he would always say Merry Christmas. He resurrected a little old Baptist church in the middle of nowhere. Started calling it Jesus Church. He wasn't known as a preacher, but he was a good speaker. I've heard him fairly often in that really old structure. In fact, I helped him when they swept it out after a gazillion years of being derelict as a building. They started having church, still having church there, as far as I know. Even though he's gone home to be with Jesus. Christmas. Think about it. I love that phrase. We don't use it all that often. Jesus is the reason for the season. Isn't it interesting that the world has taken Christmas and turned it on itself in a way with all the commercialization? And I realize, you know, manufacturers got to make money and stores got to make money, and I'm not against that. But the point of it is, it's possible to lose sight of the real meaning and the real goal. Because the goal is God with us. Emmanuel. Prince of Peace. Mighty God. The Everlasting Father. Prince of Peace. So what does a person do if they aren't following this path? Well, the first thing you need to do is accept the fact that you're a sinner. I was quoting Isaiah a while ago, Isaiah 53:6. Tells us we've all sinned and come short of the glory of God. And then once we know the truth about Jesus, then we have to trust in Him. His death and His resurrection, we not only must believe it, we must believe it in our heart of hearts. Then we ask Him to forgive us of those sins that we realize we've committed. A sin is doing something that God has told us not to do. And then another way to look at it, resign, not your job. Your other job. The job will be in you. Resign being the boss and the CEO of your own life and turn it over to Jesus. Follow his teachings. And once you do that, your life will be a constant giving of evidence of what he has done in your life. We often say the phrase, trust Jesus as your personal Savior. You know, at Christmas time, a lot of the time, Jesus is talked about in being the Savior of the world. And he is that. But the real question is he your personal I knew God was the Savior of the world. I'd been hearing it since before I was born. I'm so Baptist, I was born at 10 o'clock on Sunday morning. All that meant was that I was alive. God had presented me as a gift to my parents. And sometimes they probably wondered about how nice the gift might be. But one day, after hearing my dad preach for 16 years, and even telling somebody else the scripture verse of where to find out how to be saved, I finally realized, you know, I know all this stuff about God, but I don't think I've ever asked Jesus to come into my heart or to be my Savior or however you want to say it. You know, when I was 16, I didn't know that I needed somebody to tell me, now you let Jesus be the boss of your life. Just like if you were following the lead of a boss in a job. But I figured out a few more things since then and I realized. And sometimes it's easier to explain to people what Jesus can mean to your life if you we talk about being the Savior and turning your life over to Christ. But I don't like that. Resign. Resign of being your own boss. Turn it over to Jesus. And if you want that peace and joy to the world that we talk about and sing about this time of year. If you want to have the best Christmas you've ever had, ask Jesus Christ to be the boss of your life. And those of us who've known him for a while, it's not a bad idea to just kind of go through a little ritual and kind of re-say, God, you know, every day is a day we need to acknowledge that Jesus is our Lord, our Savior, our Master, our King. Lord, there's so much I have yet to learn. But I thank you so much for the opportunity to be able to teach from your word and to share and to preach about Jesus. Jesus, the magnificence of your saving ability and to bring the peace of mind and the peace of heart and the peace of soul that only knowing you can bring. I pray, Lord, that those here will have a renewed spirit in their heart, not just about Christmas, but about you, Jesus. And those that may be hearing me out there somewhere on the internet, that they would somehow wake up pursuits of happiness and start looking for the real peace that only you can bring. And I pray that in the mighty, magnificent, exciting name of Jesus. Amen. Would you stand with me?
As we sing our final hymn.
Let me sing a song for you, sit back down.
Eddie just reminded me that I had this plan.
So this is a song,
but it describes all the things that I've talked about.
Amen.
Amen.